welcome to the broadcast tonight, Muhammad Yunus. He won the 2006 Nobel Peace Prize. Some say he is the banker to the poor.
The reason I believe that someday we'll have a we'll create a world where only place you see poverty will be in poverty museum. Because poverty is imposed on people artificially. It's not natural to human being. Human being is comes packed with enough energy and creativity and sense of exploration into them. But society never allows them to unpack that package.
Also here, the photographer Annie Leibovitz. We look back at 15 years of her photographs.
It came out of a moment. I mean, it's not only my relationship with Susan, but you know, I had children being born, and my father also died, and a long relationship, you know, the greatest relationship of my life, you know, with my family and my parents, and so it was like uncovering, you know, as I say in the introduction, Nate, you know, it was like an archaeological dig, just uncovering and discovering these photographs.
Muhammad Yunus and Annie Leibovitz, next. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
Studios in New York City. This is Charlie Rose.
Muhammad Yunus is here. In October, he and the Grameen Bank were awarded the Nobel Peace Prize. He is one of the leading pioneers of the microfinance movement and has been called the world's banker to the poor. He founded the Grameen Bank, which has lent small sums of money to more than 6 million people in Bangladesh, most of them women. Over 100 million people in more than 100 countries will benefit from various microfinance initiatives by the end of this year. I am pleased to have him back on this program. Welcome.
Thank you. Good to be back.
Thank you. And congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Tell me what it means in terms. You worked hard at the beginning of this without recognition and just getting it done because you believed it was what you should do.
Right.
Then you began to get some attention from people like John Doerr and Bono and others recognized the work and praised you. And now this award, what does it mean in terms of the arc of what you are trying to accomplish?
Well, we have been supported by many, many people along the way. We have been opposed by many people along the way.
People didn't take you seriously.
Seriously
along the way.
Didn't pay any attention whatsoever. Right. Ignored it.
So it's a nice idea, but it's not going to do anything.
It's not going to do it. It won't work, it doesn't do any good to anybody. You're wasting your time.
Exactly.
That sort of thing. But we stayed on.
You're dreaming.
You're dreaming. It's not that easy the way you think.
Yeah, exactly.
You give a little money and everything is solved. So you got everything and the pressure.
But you never ever let it stand in the way.
You never thought
that maybe they're right. Maybe I can't do what I believe in.
I listen to everybody, try to figure out whether they have any truth in what they're saying. But I come back. I feel very confident what I'm doing was the right thing to do, and I keep doing it. And people said different things, but that didn't put me into kind of out of the picture, because I thought if you're doing something new, something people never thought about, of course people will object to you, what you're doing. Of course people will say critical things about you. It shouldn't deter you. It's your turn to convince them.
Exactly.
Change their mind, because people's mind is set in a certain way. You're trying to put it something. So instead of getting angry with them, instead of being unhappy about it, I thought that this is a responsibility from my side to present it, to demonstrate it, bring evidence to them. And I have been doing it for the last 30 years. And that is ultimately now probably is a coming to the peak with the Nobel Peace Prize, because this is suddenly the most coveted award in the whole world comes to us.
Thanks to the company you joined.
Yes, indeed. It's a great company to join.
And Nelson Mandela.
Nelson Mandela, Martin Luther King, Mother Teresa, right. You name it, them, Bishop Tutu, and right. So many other great, great people, Dalai Lama. Right. It's a fantastic company that you keep. So this is something suddenly world sits up. So what is it? Is it that good? We didn't realize that. Right. So you are lifted, you are a spirit lifted. And all the people along the way that started microcredit in different countries in the world, you mentioned 100 countries, today probably safer thing to say almost every country in the world has microcredit right now. Yeah. That's the kind of spread it got.
Let's assume there's somebody within the reach of our voice who doesn't know what we're talking about. Explain to them what we're talking about.
Well, we're talking about lending money to the poor people without collateral, without guarantee, without legal instrument, so that they can start the life earning income for themselves, for income generating activity these loans go into, and they pay back with interest, and it's a business. At the same time, it changes people's life. That business was never done before.
Why is it successful?
Successful because it was needed. There's a crying need for it, but nobody paid any attention of it. This business was left to the loan sharks. It was there all the time. But only the loan sharks are supposed to do it.
Because the banks wouldn't do it.
Banks will not do it. So you see a very strange kind of financial system where you serve only the top layer of the people, probably one-third of the world population.
Those with great credit rating.
Great credit rating, meaning that they have a lot of money.
Right.
Credit rating is nothing else that they have a lot of a stack of money behind them. So you will lend money, they'll never get lost. You'll get your money back. You tie them down with documents and the legal instruments so that they can run away from you. So you anchor your loan with their property. For poor people, there's nothing to anchor with.
Yeah.
So they said they are not creditworthy. I said, human brain is much smarter than this. They come up with ideas which you would, this will mean it can be done without collateral if you think hard enough. So we did that. We said, forget about the collateral. Poor people cannot provide collateral. Is there something that we can work with? And we did, and it worked. So today we can lend money to anybody, including the beggars. As a matter of fact, we are lending money to the beggars right now. We have 84,000 beggars.
What do they do with beggars? What do beggars do with money?
Well, what we did, we went to talk to the beggars, sit down with them, and listen to their life history, and say, it's a very hard life for you, but if you want to, as you go from house to house begging, if you want to carry some merchandise with you, little toys, little candies, little sweets that people would like to buy from you. Something very simple, something immediately say, okay, give me some. And you make money by that. And in the process, instead of you as a door-to-door beggar, you become a door-to-door salesperson. In the beginning, we thought maybe there'll be 3,000, 4,000 such people, such beggars will agree to do that. Now we are surprised there are 84,000 beggars, and they are doing great jobs and paying back their money and moving from one loan to the second loan and the third loan and so on. And many have quit begging completely because, as I said, their begging division closed down and their business division is expanded and so on because they are now a business person, really. So who are these beggars? Beggars who are their grandparents were beggars, their parents were beggars, now they are beggars. So in a generational sense, they have been begging. All you do, you give them a loan, a typical loan would be $10, $12, maximum $15. With $15 loan, if you can take one person out of begging, what a celebration, what a cause for celebration. Mm. So this is what we're talking about. You may not have changed the world, but you changed one person's generational livelihood.
Is it primarily rural?
Oh, in Bangladesh, we do it in rural areas because the law which created Grameen Bank put in the law that it should not work in the urban areas. So we keep on telling the government, please change the law so that we can work in the urban areas also. So there is nothing wrong with urban areas. Simply my law that which created
in Bangladesh.
In Bangladesh,
but in every other country, you can go straight into the urban areas.
It works right here in New York City.
How does it work right here in New York City?
Very good. Same way. People who need money, they take money, start some tiny businesses, selling things, producing things, repairing things.
Now, suppose there's somebody who is watching this now, and they have no money, and they have no collateral. How would they qualify in New York City? And what might be a typical applicant?
A typical applicant is one who is out of job, who is on welfare, who has no income of its own, depends on government subsidies and so on. She or he will come around and say, well, I would like to start a business of making dresses.
Now, do they have to have a business plan, though?
They have an idea, business plan, not in a beautiful PowerPoint presentation, but an idea, this is what I would do, and say I will need X amount of money, $100, $500, $1,000 to run this business. And with that money, I'll do this, and I'll get my money, and I'll pay you every month, every week, whatever the time.
We go to museums, and we see terrible things that are part of the past. Holocaust.
Yes.
Humans, violence against other humans as well. Wars. You believe that someday we'll go to a museum and see poverty.
Yes.
It'll be in the museum as something used to be.
That's right. That's what I believe. That's
why do you believe that? It has always been with us. The poor have always been with us.
It's because we never paid attention to the subject. So that's why they are abundant there. Nobody paid any attention to it. The reason I believe that someday we'll have we'll create a world where only place you see poverty will be in poverty museum. Because poverty is imposed on people artificially. It's not natural to human being. Human being comes packed with enough energy and creativity and sense of exploration into them. But society never allows them to unpack that package or unwrap that package to see a little bit what I have inside of me. Many people died after their whole life without ever knowing who she was, who he was, what was the gift she had inside of her, because society remained indifferent to that situation. In a way, I say that poor people are like a bonsai tree, the little tree.
Yes.
You get the seed from the best tree and plant it in a flower pot. It grows only this much. Poor people are like bonsai people. There's nothing wrong with the seed. Only society didn't allow them to the base on which they can grow. So that's why they remained the way they remain. If the society allowed them the same soil as everybody else, they would be as tall as anybody else, because nothing wrong with the person itself. Poverty is not created by the poor person. Poverty is created by the system that we have built, and even the concepts that we work with. That's what the seed of that was the problem of poverty. That's where the virus of poverty included into that. So if you can take the virus out, then there will be no poor person.
You believe it's possible to eliminate poverty?
I believe it because I see it. I see people in Grameen Bank continually coming out of poverty.
But all the poor, I mean, I don't want to make a judgment. Yeah. All the poor people are able to start a business all the poor people. I mean, I've had people come to this table. You know Jacques Attali?
Yes, I know.
It was also in microfinance.
Yes.
It said some astounding number that 50% of the people in 2000, whatever, will be living under conditions of poverty.
Well,
in other words, are we seriously making progress when we look at the number of people who are living on $1 or $2 a day?
Oh, very much. Like if you take the global figure in Bangladesh, total national figure, not just Grameen Bank, you see poverty is reducing in Bangladesh in the decade of 90s by 1% per year. So during the 90s, whole decade, there's nearly 10% reduction in poverty in terms of population. And then during the first 5 years of 2000, the poverty has been reducing in 2% average for five years. So if you can maintain that or even improve slightly over 2%, Bangladesh will be guaranteed to reach the Millennium Development Goal of reducing the number of poor people by half by 2015. We are right on the track. We are absolutely on the dot every year that we have done. So if we can reduce poverty by half by 2015 in Bangladesh, this is a good news for every country around the world. So this is a concrete thing. This is not fancy thought or something that you wishful thinking. It's a real situation. And within Grameen Bank, 58% of the Grameen Bank borrowers who have been with Grameen Bank for 5 years or more have moved out of poverty. So again, it's a very consistent progress.
Is it your judgment that this will be the primary vehicle for eliminating poverty? Not foundations, not government, but some capacity to enable the poor to do for themselves.
Yes, that's very important.
Education is important.
Very important. Everything is important. What I'm saying that if you want the microcredit, whether it is brought by foundations, whether it is brought by microcredit banks, whoever does it, if it does a good job, this would be a very important contribution in getting poor people out. But we need everything else also, ensuring that if one gets out of poverty, he or she remains out of poverty, doesn't slip back again. Yeah. It's not a come and go kind of situation. So I'm saying health is very important. Being poor means being in poor health. It's a synonymous thing. Yeah. What happened to our health program? Why aren't we building the health program which reaches to the poor people? Many countries.
That's government responsibility.
Many countries is solely government responsibility, although they spend a lot of money from their budget, but it stays with the top people. It doesn't go down to the poor people. So why aren't you making alternatives like we did in banking, alternative banking? Why aren't you doing alternative health care for the poor people? And I call this kind of alternative arrangement as a social business, business to do good to people rather than making money. You make money somewhere else, but there are issues that where you shouldn't be looking for money. You should be looking for doing good to people. Healthcare is one. You can run it as a business. These social businesses are businesses which are non-loss, non-dividend companies. Mm-hmm. So you are not going there for dividends. You measure your success by seeing how many poor people have been reached with your healthcare program, how many poor people has access to pure drinking water,
right.
Clean water, how many people have sanitation in their houses, how many poor people have decent houses, as a business, not as a charity. Charity is wonderful, but it has limited reach. You can't solve all the world of the problem of the world by charity. So if you put it in a business format, then there is a chance. You can reach out to everybody because it's a recycling of money and money stays on. You can expand the business and so on.
You're the sort of the founder of this movement. What are the new ideas that are sort of coming out of it?
One is expanding the different types of banking, like you put insurance into it. Lots of different insurance products is important. Varieties of savings products is important. Access to information technology is important. Like in our case, we created a telephone company, mobile telephone company, and giving loans to the borrowers to buy themselves mobile phones and become the telephone lady of the village.
Yeah.
And make a good money. Now we are coming to a stage where not only they will have telephone service, they will have internet services to those telephones, because now the technology allows you use the mobile phone for internet telephony and internet creating internet kiosk for them. So their children will be different kind of people. So these are all important issues, having information technology. And then other one, we have been in Grameen Bank for the last 30 years doing this. Now a new generation is coming out of these families, because 30 years is a long time. Those children are born after the mother joined the Grameen Bank. He or she grew up with Grameen Bank. So new generation of children who are growing up within the format of microcredit and so on. So we are helping them to go to school, many of them going to higher education, becoming doctors, engineers, and so on and so forth. So we want to see that the new generation is totally different, totally updated than their parents. Mm-hmm. Parents are illiterate, but the new generation is highly qualified.
In not so much in terms of microfinance, simply as one weapon to fight poverty, but the overall effort to fight poverty, is globalization a good idea, a positive force, for the most part?
Globalization as a concept is a great idea, but as an implementation, you create a lot of question marks. Like, are we doing the right globalization, or we are on the track of the wrong globalization? This is an issue that needs to be discussed and resolved.
Okay, stop there.
Yes.
What's the difference in the good globalization and the bad globalization? Are we creating good or bad?
Yes. Good globalization is a globalization where everybody benefits. It's a win-win globalization. A bad globalization is a one-way win, and the other one is lose. The rich country, powerful companies take over poor countries and poor economies. That's a bad globalization. Globalization, rich country get richer, poor country gets better. That's a good globalization.
Is globalization mostly good or mostly bad?
At the moment, it's bad.
Mostly bad.
Mostly bad, because it's a threat. You can take over the economy, you can control the economy, because you are big, I can't compete with you. The way I would explain it is globalization is a kind of a 20-lane highway, moving from one end of the world to other end of the world. But these are now monopolized by the big trucks from the USA, Europe. Little rickshaw from Bangladesh has no place, it's blown away from the highway, because there is no traffic rules. That's just important. There's no traffic police.
So what's the answer to this issue?
Answer is, why don't we have our traffic rules so that we know if the big companies go to a poor countries, how they shall behave. When a new company...
And how do they leave money in the...
In the country.
In the country, not take it all back.
This is very important. These are the traffic rules.
And how do you make sure that they are not exploiting the people?
Exactly. You don't destroy their livelihood.
In fact, they are. Enriching the lives of people.
Exactly. And you don't concern your environmental issues. You go someplace else, you exhaust them, everything.
Where there are no environmental issues, and therefore you can probably make a product cheaper. You know, with no respect for the environment, you may be able to do it cheaper. Although the green movement is...
Absolutely. You have to maintain the resources of the world. Just because you are powerful, you take everything out and let the next generation or the other countries suffer because you already exhausted all the resources the world has because you have all the power. So there should be rules. If the world, even if you have it in your excess, in your command, but this is a resource for the whole world. So that we can share them. If you have the access to water resource, it's a water resource for everybody. If you have access to mineral resources, mineral resource for everybody. Just because you have access, you can't exhaust it and say, we enjoyed it, you do whatever you want to do. You cannot do that. So those are the traffic rules. So when you have traffic rules, you'll have to have traffic police so that you maintain that this is the kind of thing we have to do with total agreement. That's why global institutions become important. On globalization, there is no global institution. It's an anarchy in globalization. Anarchy doesn't lead to good results. There must be a system, there must be an understanding, there must be mutual respect.
And how will it come about?
If Charlie Rose, keep talking about it, it will come about. If we talk about it, it will come about. People will think. Because if you leave it to the bureaucrats, they will do whatever the best they think. And people have to speak out that we have to share this planet together. And in the name of globalization, we cannot plunder. Globalization can become a financial colonialization. We got it from the past political colonialization, and we plundered under that regime also. Now we come under new colonialization, plunder in the name of globalization. So we have to protect ourselves from that. And good, well-meaning people are everywhere. They understand that, and that well-meaning people has to speak out and make the world safer for the future.
It's great to see you.
Great to see you. Thank you.
When do you go to Oslo to accept?
10th of December, I'll be there. I hope you can come too.
Oh, I'd love to come.
Yes, please do. We'll be so delighted.
Have you started to write your speech?
I should be doing soon, yes. I'll do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Muhammad Yunus, Nobel Prize winner, Peace Prize winner, 2006. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Annie Leibovitz is here. She is perhaps the best-known American photographer around. She started in rock and roll. She went to Hollywood, and along the way, she found family. In 1973, she became the chief photographer of Rolling Stone magazine, where she stayed until 1983. Her intimate portraits of celebrities have defined the look of the magazine. Since 1983, she has worked as a featured photographer for Vanity Fair magazine. She has also published 6 books of her photographs. Her most recent one is called 9 Pounds. No, it's called A Photographer's Life, 1990 to 2005. In it, Annie publishes celebrity photographs as well as portraits of family members, her 3 children, and perhaps the most important person in her life, Susan Sontag. Susan Sontag died in 2004 after a long battle with cancer. She has said, "A thing that you see in my pictures is that I was not afraid to fall in love with these people." This book is a testament to that. I am pleased to have Annie Leibovitz back at this table. Welcome. Hi. Nice to see you.
Thank you. Good to see you, too.
Oh, yes, thank you.
I was worried about you for a while. Yeah.
You said something interesting. I mean, this is your life.
Well, it's the last 15 years. It's chapter 2. It's a look back. The last 15 years. I had a book that came out in 1970-1990, which was the first time I stopped and took a look. And this is the second time, and it wasn't anything I expected it to be, really.
What do you mean?
Well, I had planned, the book was due to Random House. The Random House was due a retrospective style book, and a lot of things happened, and most importantly, Susan Sontag died, and we just buried Susan in Paris, and I woke up a couple of mornings later, and I said, my gosh, the years that I'm supposed to work on the book, 1990 to 2005 are the years I was with Susan. And I just got very excited because I thought, I'm going to look at my work as if Susan was standing in back of me, as if she was there, working with me to put the book together. And coincidentally, I was working with Sharon Delano on a small memorial book, a book that was going to be put out at her memorial service here in New York. And I went looking for photographs. She was photographed by so many great photographers. I mean, all the great photographers of our time, and Cartier-Bresson, Diane Arbus, Richard Avedon. So I went looking for my own photograph of her to put in this little book, and I saw the beginning of this work that I just really didn't realize I had, and I wouldn't have looked for it if Susan hadn't died, and I thought it was so strong and so interesting. And so I put myself, in my barns in upstate New York, and I took one wall and edited my personal work on one wall. And on the other wall, I lined up my assignment work, and I asked Mark Holborn to come over from England to actually help me, decide if it could actually go together. And then we put it together. And that's what you have. I mean, it really came out of a moment. It came out of a moment. I mean, it's not only my relationship with Susan, but, I had children being born, and my father also died, and a long relationship, the greatest relationship of my life, with my, family and my parents. And so it was like uncovering, as I say in the introduction, Nate, it was like an archaeological dig, just uncovering and discovering these photographs. It was really,
It was what I said, it was your life. It was your life. Because
it's still going.
Yes, I know, but it was your life in a sense that these were, this was not just some work of art you had done. These were people that had influenced you, shaped you, celebrated with you, shared with you, lived with you.
The people who put up with you.
Exactly.
Really. I mean, the people who put up with you taking these kinds of pictures, which allows you to be intimate.
The pictures of you and the children taken in some cases by Susan.
That's right. And in fact, the photograph on the cover is a photograph that Susan took of me.
That's a fabulous photograph, too. This is in Venice, right?
Yes, in Venice.
At the Gritti Hotel.
Gritti Palace, yeah.
Yeah. When you said about her, she probably wouldn't have liked it if she was living, but if now that she's dead, mm-hmm. she would have wanted me to do it, and she would have urged me to do it.
Absolutely. It was certainly, every single concern that anyone might have about these photographs. You know, I sort of went through it myself. I mean, I really thought very carefully about what I was doing, and because the initial edit came out of, you know, came out of that moment of grief, and there was no doubt in my mind. I mean, Susan was a very private person. This is, you know, if she was alive, these pictures would not be published. And but it's different. She's gone now, and you know, she always liked a good fight. She liked to be. She liked a great discussion.
Yes.
She likes. You know, she was. You know, on the Harvard debate team, and yeah. You know, she liked. She would champion. You know, these pictures. I have no doubt in my mind. You know, she. You know, she would be proud of them.
Yeah. And if anybody objected, she'd be prepared to make the argument as to why they belonged here.
Right. I mean, there were the most difficult pictures. I think were the ones at the, towards the very end.
Her death.
I mean,
near death.
I didn't have any problem at all with the intimacy, you know, the photographs of intimacy. There was more, you know, these pictures at the very end, those were the hardest ones. Those were the ones that, you know, were on and off the board. And I had a wonderful talk with this woman who, the psychologist who worked with cancer patients who, you know, for over years, you know, helping them die. And she felt, you know, it was they were important pictures to be seen, because in this country, you know, we are so sort of cut off from death, and that, you know, and that, you know, and also illness, and that she said this is something, you know, you see every day. It's part of life, you know. So, I mean, that's the argument that I think Susan would have had, you know. Mm-hmm.
Let's take a look at the photographs and then come back. In fact, we have she did a number of conversations with me at this table, as you know.
I know. I feel. I just did the 92nd Street Y, and you know, it's hard to go anywhere without, you know, thinking of her. You know, I used to accompany her to those talks, and there I was standing on that stage, and it's just, you know, I when I come here, I think of her. I really do think of her, and I know you had a really, you know, a beautiful, great relationship. So she
Thank
loved
you.
Coming here.
And she did, or even debating a dinner. We didn't have to be
yes,
here.
No.
She would take me on wherever
we were
I was.
Table. Exactly. That was that. She'd love to do that, you know.
Yeah. All right. This is a photograph. This is in Wainscott, Long Island, 1988. I mean, just talk about these photographs as we show them. This will be Susan and photographs that have appeared in Vanity Fair magazine and everywhere else.
It's hard because I mean, I will say that you know, the book is a piece of sculpture, and the book has. As you can see, it's so heavy, and it's almost the photographs sort of comfort each other, and it's hard when you pull them out and separate them. There is a different agenda. I just wanted to, like, you know, point that out. But
explain more so that I understand. I mean, to point them out individually is
because there's such a big story, you know, inside of it. It's like a small movie, and it's sort of like taking a little scene out of a movie.
Gotcha. Yeah.
And it really is like a memoir in photographs, and it has a kind of a pacing to it, and a movement to it. And it was very, very well thought out that way. I almost cringe every time I see, you know, several pictures taken out of the book, and in the book, the book is a great place for the photographs. It's the only place for the photographs. It's you know, taken out of it's harder. I just wanted to say
that.
I understand.
But that being said, let's do this. I hear you, and it's well
that's
said.
Susan,
that's Susan. That's Scott.
Yeah, the beginning of our relationship. That's it. Out in Long Island, it's again taken. It's pretty. You know, there's very little text in the book. There's just captions to let you know where you are. And Sharon Galeno forced me to write this introduction, to work on this introduction over many conversations that we had, long evenings, because she felt that things needed to be explained. And the introduction does sort of do that. But that being said,
what brought you together?
Well, in fact, Sharon Delano actually had introduced us. She needed a photograph taken for AIDS and its metaphors, and she ended up not using it for the book jacket. Tom Victor was her photographer up to that point. He died of AIDS, and I met her, and you know, I think I was just flattered that, you know, she was interested in me, and she liked me, and you know, she was such a great, extraordinary person. You know,
so were you.
Well. you know, it's...
But it was one of those things.
I think it was just this moment. She came into my life at just this really, you know, great time. And I mean, the perfect time. And I think I wanted to, you know, I was interested in whether or not my work, you know, could be better. And she was interested, of course, in photography, like she was interested in so many things. And she said, you know, well, you know, you're good, but you could be better. And, you know, I loved the way she just raised the bar. I mean, there was no satisfying her ever, you know, on some level. You know, it was always like you were running after her.
Did she satisfy herself?
I think she did on occasion. I think she really enjoyed writing her fiction. I think she really enjoyed, you know, she was in love with The Volcano Lover. But the book is, I mean, I have to steer you away, you know, from Susan, because it's more than Susan. It really is.
No, I'm getting to that, but these first three pictures, you got to bear with me, okay?
I'm
just going through them, then we'll get to some other stuff.
I know. I mean, it's a love story, and there's a reason I did it, you know, because, you know, I wanted to be clear about that, you know.
That it's a love story.
Yeah. That's part of the book, yes.
Okay. There's another one here. This is in Mexico. Yeah. The next one is Susan in a hotel room.
Grady Palace.
Yeah. It's in Grady Palace as well.
That's actually the first trip.
Yeah. We're doing things that are not easy for you in part, beyond Susan. But I mean, you have just said that this book is a book of photographs that tell a story of a life, your life. And you take them out and you're looking at a snapshot rather than a motion picture. Yes?
I think the book is the proper place for it. It's hard. Right. I mean, it's hard to talk about the pictures separated from each other. But of course, you can, and you will, and
it's inevitable.
But the assignment work is there also as sort of you know, markers for time. You know, because the book is in chronological order, and.
I'm not all in chronological order here, so you have to excuse me. This is a famous photograph you took of Demi Moore, pregnant with Bruce Willis' child as well. This was in 1991. This is chosen, by the way, I'm not sure it was this particular photograph, as one of the two most best magazine cover photographs in the last 25 years.
I know, I was really surprised. That and the John and Yoko is what I was
exactly.
Told.
And by the way, who took them both?
Well, I did the John and
yes.
Yoko also.
But of course you did.
I think there must have been someone on that committee who I knew or something.
No, it wasn't. Someone on that committee who understood. So what is it about you and being able to capture these moments?
I don't know if, I mean, do you want to talk specifically about a moment, or do you want to talk about, talk about a photograph?
Well, let's
talk
about this one. Talk about Demi Moore.
Well, Demi Moore, I mean,
Why did you see this?
Demi Moore is actually in this collection because, I mean, there are not too many iconic photographs in this collection of pictures, but Demi Moore is there because, you know, I had photographed Demi many, many times. I actually photographed her and Bruce's wedding. And I photographed her when she was pregnant with her first child. And this was her second child. We were doing a cover for Vanity Fair. And there was a big concern about how to photograph her. She was, you know, she was pregnant, you know, we need to come in close. And you know, there was a concern, how do you take this picture? And, you know, I did my close-ups and we, and then I said to Demi, well, let's do some nudes for you, you know, like as I had done previously for her, you know, privately. And so she started to pose, and I said, why can't this be a cover? And then we tried trying to figure out how to hide, you know, hide.
But you didn't start out thinking this is a cover. You just were doing that. This was not some sense that I will do it, and then she'll see it, and she'll recognize how beautiful it is, and people will accept something they couldn't imagine going in.
Absolutely. I mean, what was interesting is when I brought the pictures back to New York, you know, Tina Brown was nervous about, you know,
the editor of Vanity Fair.
That's right. About running, you know, the picture. And then Susan loved the picture and called Tina and said, you know, you have to run this. This is really great. And, you know, and I think it did
there's
help.
There's Susan you know, butting in again.
No, I know, but that's, you know, Susan loved popular culture. She was, you know, she loved.
And so do you.
I do. I've been doing this a long time since.
I mean, what is it about this? I mean, is it the celebrity? Is it because it is the sort of music of our time? What is it?
No, because since I've been doing it for so long, since the 1970s, that I feel very responsible to the whole body of work. And I think it's an interesting body of work. And it's the hardest thing to be in the middle of all of this and try to do something good in it. And I'm interested in, you know. I'm interested in trying to do something that matters and good in popular work.
Yeah.
And I think it's, you know, they could be winning, it seems like. It's like, I think they are winning. I mean, and that's why it was so wonderful to do this. You get older and you start to think, well, my God, you know, this is really hard. There is such an obsession with celebrity now.
Yeah.
And that's why it was so refreshing to turn, I guess, to myself as an example in this book.
As a celebrity.
I don't think of myself as a celebrity. I really think of myself.
No,
these pictures are so personal, and they really are, you know, it's, you know, you don't stop seeing. You're looking all the time. So, you know, and you know, when I'm with, as I said before, when I was, you know, with, whether it was Susan or my parents or my children, you know, those are the ones that will put up with you, and you can take these kinds of pictures. And I think there's something refreshing. I mean, I felt like, I think we all want to be, we want to see things that feel more real, you know, that are more real. I mean, we're tired of making things up, you know, all the time. And so I think that, I'm very, very surprised, Charlie, there. The response to the book has been really very, very nice, you know, very, very supportive.
And why are you surprised at that?
Well, because
you
are
so good.
Because
I
thought it was a gamble. You know, there's very, very, you know, intimate pictures in here.
Right,
and I think that especially the pictures at the end of the book, you know, I mean.
Because it's about death.
Yeah, well, because they're so graphic.
Yeah.
And you know, Susan's not even recognizable at some level.
Right.
And but I think that I don't know. I'm so surprised how I didn't know. I really didn't know. And God knows why. You know, on some level, that I published them. I mean, that's a whole other. You know, I'll be thinking about that. You know, for a long time. Except for the fact that I am a photographer, and I'm a working photographer.
Except for the fact you are an artist.
And I felt it's, you know, it best represented these last 15 years.
You're an artist. This is what you do. And to hold back would be editing yourself.
Well, there's not a place for this work in the magazines. I mean, this is the place for it. I mean, I would like to see more work like this in the magazines. I really would.
More open, more unrestrained, more raw,
all of
more
this.
Honest.
Yes, yes. I mean, it's a great tradition. I mean, the early life magazine work, you know, the Country Doctor. I mean, those are just great, great essays. And it's not like there aren't really good photographers taking really good pictures. But I think we should be doing more of this kind of work. And I'm hoping that this sort of creates a platform for that.
Okay. Let me see more of these because not to show you your photographs would be crazy. All right, Los Angeles 1992 is the next one.
No, you can show the pictures. I was just giving you a hard time.
No, I know. This is obviously Mick Jagger.
It was done for an album jacket, actually.
But I mean,
you're going to ask me the dates, aren't you?
No, I'm not. I have it 1992. Mm-hmm. But what did you say to him? Is there words spoken? Do you get them right for this? Do you have no idea what you're looking for, but you know you're looking for something different?
I was the tour photographer for the Rolling Stones in '75, '76, and I knew this very quiet side of Mick Jagger, and this kind of very beautiful side. Yeah. I mean, you know, Keith Richards called him, you know, the girl singer of the band, you know, and it always sort of stuck with me. And he was such a, I mean, there were moments during that tour where I almost saw Mick almost sort of float up to the ceiling. I mean, he was so ethereal. And so I wanted, you know, I think we all think of Jagger as, you know, jumping Jack Flash. And I think that I wanted to take a quieter picture.
Yeah. Okay. Next one is Mikhail Baryshnikov and Rob Besser,
yeah.
Right. This is in Georgia, 1990.
This was the start of that was the other series of pictures I did that were very, very strong, because I spent about 3 weeks in Florida while Baryshnikov, you know, started his White Oak Dance project with Mark Morris, and this was the creation of a dance. It was a beautiful dance that Mark made for Misha, and he had Rob Besser lifting Misha up.
Yeah.
You know, as if he was flying through the air.
The next one is, again, Susan in bed.
Well, that's in Capri. You can see she's very busy doing research on the volcano lover.
Right. next are your parents with their grandson, Ross. Right. This is in Wainscott in 1992.
That boy is now 6'5" and going to MIT. you know, the family bed was very, very important. You know, we used to jump in bed on Sunday mornings, you know, and read the funnies. And
he's 6'5"?
He's huge. Yeah. He's like 6'5".
Next is Mulholland Drive in Los Angeles.
I was setting up lights in the other in Jack Nicholson's living room, and he was gone. I didn't know where he was, and I had to go look for him. He was out on his terrace knocking these golf balls off of his. You know, this is real. I mean, this is really real. Right. And I just took this picture because I couldn't believe he was doing that. I don't know who lives below him.
Brad Pitt is next in Las Vegas in 1994.
It was early in Brad's career, and he was, you know, kicking and screaming, didn't really want to take these pictures. You know?
Yeah, we'll say that.
Yeah. He was like, and now he's really quite different.
Yeah, accepting of celebrity. Next is, and these are pictures about power. And this was a famous one that you got. How you got them all together, I don't know.
Well, that is the remarkable thing about the picture. I don't necessarily think it's a good photograph other than they all actually sat for that picture. And, you know, when you go into the White House, the door's open, and then you leave and the door's shut, you know?
So. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But from Powell to Cheney to Bush to Condé Rice, George Tenet in the front, and Don Rumsfeld and Andy Carr, the chief of staff.
No, it was definitely a coup. I mean, I think they thought they should do some publicity, and it was... I don't know if it was a very good idea.
And people like that, you know, you want the best. Okay, next is Nicole Kidman here in New York 3 years ago.
That was done for Vogue. There's very little work in this book from Vogue.
We have it.
The Vogue work is, I love the Vogue work. It's like it's just fantasy, and it's fantasy, and you're allowed to just go with it and not, I really, you know, it's a very different kind of work, and this is one of the few pictures
Does this represent it too?
It does. You know, we were at Versailles.
Yes.
And everything was just over the top.
Yeah.
You know, it was just I couldn't believe we were actually at Versailles. In fact, one of the dresses that Vogue had several designers make some dresses for the shoot, and there was one that was like, it looked like a series of garbage bags, you know, like, you know, huge garbage bags. It was a huge dress, and I decided to do that last because I was afraid they would throw us out of Versailles.
Yeah. Whatever the technical skill is there, is it in the end the sense that, help me tell the story. Mm-hmm. I mean, is it knowing? You knew that Jagger was the quiet side, you knew. And so you wanted to capture that. You know something you want to capture.
Those are going to be your best pictures, absolutely. I mean, that's what's interesting about the book, again, is that the best pictures are the ones that I've spent, I know the people, and I knew, you know, and I had the time with them. It's no accident that the Rolling Stone pictures that I did from the Rolling Stone tour were good because I was with them for a long period of time. I mean, I don't think things can be done so fast.
And I think those
are going to be the better pictures, the ones that you spend time on and you know what you're doing.
But the point is not that you have time to shoot that many photographs, which it may be, but it's you get to know them, so therefore you can
absolutely
you learn what it is that is at their essence. and then the difficult thing is trying to capture that.
You know, you're not always going to get that. I mean, I don't believe in this, you know, let's get to that. You're going, you know, I hear this a lot. Oh, you capture that person. I don't know if that's not true. You have a part of that person. But this idea of getting to the heart of the matter, I mean, it's going to happen like 5 times a year or something like that. It doesn't really, I mean, the surface is interesting. I mean, it's not uninteresting. It's, and sometimes it's better just to stay on the surface. Sometimes you don't want to go any deeper.
Well, which photograph reflects that, my dear?
Well, I'm not going there.
All right. The next one is leaving Seattle in 2004.
Yeah.
There you go.
Well, that is the bone marrow transplant has right. failed, you know, for Susan, and I went to Seattle to bring her home and in an air ambulance. And there are photographs in the book when she was sick in 98, and I spent it took a month off, and I was in the hospital with her a lot, but it was nowhere like this last time she was sick, which was a really harrowing experience. This bone marrow transplant, I don't know if you know anyone who's experienced that.
Yes.
And it's
and
very,
for it to
difficult.
Fail is just.
And she, yeah. And
your hopes are there, and it's
fighter.
The only shot you have, and has all
was,
of that.
She was such a fighter, and she really wanted to live, and she wanted to write more books. And she, you know, this was just a very sad moment. I didn't take any pictures really that last year. And but when I went out to pick her up, picked up my camera, and started to take pictures.
And even after she died?
After she died, that is not as difficult a photograph for me. That is more that's in the tradition of photography. I mean, very early on, photography was used to photograph people, to hold on to loved ones. You know, to photograph people after they died, and that was a very conscious decision. I talked to David Reif, her son, and discussed with him that I was going to do it, and it was fine.
Here is finally Philip Johnson. Then before, I'm just for the benefit of those, is Philip Johnson at his house in Connecticut. Before that, we're going to see two things. One, right. Susan, and then a surprise for you from a fellow photographer I got to know reasonably well. Roll the tape of Susan on this program. From 2000. Here it is.
I came of age as an adult and as a writer in the 1960s. I was a student in the 50s, and I came to New York at the beginning of the 60s. It was a time of enormous public debate, to put it mildly. I mean, I'm trying to take down the usual way in which the 60s is talked about in a very hysterical way, and just say it's a time of really, really active debate. I did get caught up in that, and I did think that was a great thing to do, to be part of public debate and influence people about things you cared about. I never wanted to attack things. I wanted to promote the things that I loved. I think my own very evangelical, moralistic, again, very American streak kind of got the better of me. I was sort of interested in plugging the good, the true, and the beautiful, as I understood that to be. Other people might have thought it was a little weird, but I thought it was very mainstream and wholesome. And I got a little stranded. It's almost I didn't understand the ethical power that fiction could have. I understood much better the ethical power that an essay could have. Mm. I think that was a kind of mistake that I made. I mean, I don't renounce that work, but I think I sold fiction short in my own mind. And I was too involved in an ethical way in various struggles. I mean, starting with the Vietnam War and this and that and the other. And it took me a long way to get to a better idea of fiction.
I have to leave with that notion. It is that it perhaps, rather than bemoaning the fact that you didn't start earlier, sometimes you have to make the journey to get there.
That's right.
You know?
Well, that's true wisdom. That is true wisdom, to know that the journey is not set, and you can do it as you can.
God. There's so much more to say here. To look at this, and sometimes this is like looking at this book. This book, much more intimate, but it is about a life. And all these magazines are here, are all the things that that Annie has done. This book has been celebrated also in Newsweek magazine with cover story here, My Life in Pictures, from Celebrity to Family, an exclusive excerpt from America's best-known photographer. It has been a remarkable life, and this book captures 15 years of it, and I'm honored that you would stop here and talk to us. Thank you. Pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. See you next time. Funding for Charlie Rose has been provided by the following.
For every drop of yourself you give, get every drop back. We offer over 80 ways to hydrate, energize, nourish, relax, or enjoy every drop of life.
Charlie Rose on PBS is brought to you in part by JPMorgan Chase, providing financial services and solutions to more than 30 million consumers, institutions, corporations, and governments worldwide.
Additional funding for Charlie Rose was also provided by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.